The 2014 Progress Seminar invited people from local business, government, and the community to take a weekend retreat and collaborate on regional issues. With several networking receptions, seminar speeches, and dedicated breakout sessions, they had keynote speeches from San Mateo County Board of Supervisor President Dave Pine with the State of the County Address, San Francisco Business Times publisher Mary Huss on the state of Bay Area print media, futurist and economist Dr. Lowell Catlett on the new middle class, and CEO Marci Harris of PopVox, which bridges the gap between the input the public wants to provide and the information members of Congress want and need to receive. The breakout session topics included, is water more precious than gold? The big lift, the road less traveled, new transportation opportunities for the 21st century, communications and customers in a digital age, and a roundtable dialogue with your elected state officials, including Senator Jerry Hill of the California State Senate, 13th District, Assemblymember Rich Gordon of the California State Assembly, 24th District, and Assemblymember Kevin Mullen of the California State Assembly, 22nd District. For more videos from the Progress Seminar, go to www.penntv.tv/videos/specials/Progress Seminar.
Marci Harris. One more thing before we get going. Where's Amy and Barbara and Carolina and Holly? Where are you guys? Thank you so much. You all know that we really wouldn't be here without them. You know that. So thank you guys. You're great. My partner in crime and the co-chair of the Progress Seminar, council member, past mayor from City of Redwood City, CEO of SAMCETA, and many, many other large accomplishments. But today she's going to be here with our guest, with our special guest, and conduct an interview. So Roseanne, it's all yours.
Give us any photos with coconut shells. We would very much appreciate having those handed in at the door. So, just a thought. The other thing that I want to mention is John Stone in the room? I don't think he's here yet, but he will be coming. Special things happen at the Progress Seminar. Very special things. Yesterday, Charles was on the phone with Vice President Joe Biden because he has a very close friend that knew how much he liked and respected Vice President Biden. So the Vice President said, I'd like to call him. Well, he was in one of our breakouts and he didn't pick up the phone. So the Vice President said, okay, well, we'll try later, and he did. And so, I mean, this is the kind of special things that happen, and it's because of all of you that are here, that are a part of this, how connected you are, and how much you appreciate everything that we do together from San Mateo County. So now it is both an honor and a privilege for me to introduce our keynote this morning. It's going to be a conversation with Marci Harris, who is the Chief Executive Officer and one of the co-founders of PopVox. Let me give you a little bit about Marci's background. Her public service work began as a tornado recovery coordinator for Jackson, Tennessee, working on private and public organizations, state, local, and regional federal agencies to marshal resources and rebuild. In 2007, she became tax, trade, and health counsel to Congressman Pete Stark, then chairman of the Health Subcommittee of Ways and Means, and was a committee lead for Medicare program integrity and physician payment sunshine provisions of the House Health Reform Bill. She left the Hill in February of 2010 to build PopVox. She holds a JD from the University of Memphis and an LLM from American University's Washington College of Law. Marci, come up and tell us a little bit about PopVox, and then we're going to have a conversation. Let's all welcome Marci Harris.
Thank you so much, Roseanne and Amy. It's such a pleasure to be here. I was so excited when I read the list of all the people who would be here, especially because I love local government. And as I came up here to get in the mood, I had my podcast downloaded and I was driving listening to a talk from Benjamin J. Barber entitled, If Mayors Ruled the World. And I didn't know about what was going to happen at the luau last night, so that makes it an all much more interesting picture. But his point was that at the local level, there's a much more nonpartisan and practical approach to governing than, he says, there's no Democratic or Republican way to fix a sewer. And so The local government is where the rubber meets the road, as so many of you know who are in local government and work with local government here in our wonderful Bay Area. But as Rosie mentioned, my interaction with local government was a little less planned. I had been running the mayor's campaign in Jackson, Tennessee. He was an incumbent. It wasn't a big deal. He'd been around for 5 terms, so all I did was organize chicken dinners and visits to senior centers. And in the last week, the very important job of the campaign manager was to make sure all the yard signs were out and in the right places. So, I mean, I was going with volunteers. I had blisters all over my hands. We had yard signs. We had canvassed the place. You couldn't go anywhere in Jackson, Tennessee without seeing a yard sign. And it was just before the election. The sky was starting to darken a little bit. And I got home, and that night, an F4 tornado came through the town and destroyed the historic downtown area, a residential area near there with 3,000 homes. And in some places, those yard signs were the only things left standing. It's amazing. But that morning, as everybody was kind of waking up and surveying what they could see, making their way downtown, I called the mayor and asked him what I needed to do. And his instruction to me was, find out what people need and get it. And that was my job. That became my job for the next year and a half, as I was the only person who kind of was there to pick up the responsibility of coordinating all the work that was happening within the planning department, the building department, the volunteer coordinators, the Chamber of Commerce trying to keep people downtown, the churches trying to get help to people whose homes had been destroyed. So it was one of the most incredible experiences I've ever had. But Rahm Emanuel, I think, is famous for saying, never let a crisis go to waste. I think that was the quote. And he meant it in a little bit different way. The quote that we looked to as we started to rebuild in Jackson was from Pablo Picasso, who said, every act of creation is first an act of destruction. And what that tornado did for us was that it created the opportunity to come together and think about what we were going to do next in a way that completely cleared away, literally and metaphorically, everything that had been before. And there was something really powerful in that. And in the emergency of the day in, day out of what you do after clearing out the trees and what you do as you get the tarps on the houses and you know how you'd put one foot in front of the other as you go forward. One of the things that became necessary was having an 8 o'clock meeting with the department heads every morning. Coffee there, what's going on? People who felt connected and a part of something bigger in a way that they never had before. And even though they were dealing with more challenges than they'd ever had before them, at one point the mayor looked to the director of public works and said, "How are you doing?" And he said, I'm having the time of my life. And I think we all know what that feels like when you have a strong sense of purpose. You feel like you're on a very united team with a goal and just living in the present, taking one step at a time and doing what you can to make things work. So now after that experience, I say my first startup was a town. And that's because we brought people together. We had a dreaming session. Everybody wrote down what they would like to see the town become. We published those in the newspaper. It became a redevelopment plan. We passed it through the city council and the county commission, and we were on our way to rebuilding. And the mayor came to me and he said, "It's time for you to go to law school." And I said, "But we've got so much to do." And he said, "And if you don't, I'm going to fire you." And so that's how I made the transition. Otherwise, I'd probably still be there. But it was a very important decision for me to go to law school. I had, you know, experienced dealing with administrative agencies at the state level and the federal level as we went about rebuilding, writing a grant for FEMA, going to Capitol Hill to beg for earmarks and any help we could get in rebuilding. And I wanted to understand the process. There was so much that didn't work in my experience as I sat with people whose homes had been destroyed, trying to figure out how they were going to get through the next few weeks or few months, and then went to Washington to talk about the environmental study that had to take place before we could submit the grant for the FEMA mitigation piece that had not yet been approved in the appropriations bill that might come later, but it was going to be an omnibus and da 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 da. Anybody feel me? I was very frustrated, and just like with, I think the tornado had given me confidence that people can pull together and get things done in the face of great problems. So I just wanted to learn more about it. So from law school in Memphis, I went to Washington, to American University, to focus on a program called Law and Government with a heavy focus in administrative law. I am a regulatory geek. I love that stuff. But while I was there, I did an internship on Capitol Hill, which I'm sure there are a few people here who've done the same, and interned with the Ways and Means Committee. And it was a unique privilege. It was a unique frustration. It was, I was about 30 years old at the time when I became what I felt like was the world's oldest intern. And it's such a humbling experience. I was, making copies and getting lost in the Capitol basement, and the Capitol Hill police were so kind as I had that look on my face, like I have no idea where I'm going, and leading the way. But it was a very important experience, and learning my way around Capitol Hill is something that I continue to use. But while I was there, I got extremely frustrated with the way information flows in. Information from organizations, from lobbyists, from companies, I found that I needed the information about X issue almost to the day of when I had thrown it away the day before. So I would get a stack of one-pagers from people I met with. They would, topple on my desk, and then I'd finally clean it off, and then the bill would be introduced the next week that related to the one-pagers that I had just gotten rid of. And it was similar with the constituent input that was coming in. Just, I was so moved and so honored to receive the letters or take the meetings or the phone calls from the people from the 13th District of California who had very personal stories about how a policy would affect them. And certainly covering healthcare, that becomes all the more important when someone sits with you and tells you how policy affects their child. And I thought to myself, I shouldn't be the only one hearing this. These discussions are out in the greater country. Everyone is talking about these policies, and I'm sitting on this letter, and if I don't share it with someone, nobody's gonna know how this policy affects X person or X business or X community. And so I was very frustrated with this system, not to mention that technology had made it so much easier for massive quantities of information to flow in. Our advocacy system started with direct mail when you actually, it was a big deal to generate a ton of postcards or letters to Capitol Hill. But as the cost to doing that came down, the volume just increased and increased and increased. And for members of Congress, as you all know, they really care what their constituents have to say. They don't care so much what the whole internet has to say. And so trying to cut through the noise of what was coming in and find out what was real, what was from a real constituent, what needed to be listened to, was very difficult. So I sat there with a list of all the things I thought somebody should do to fix this, and everybody I brought it to said, that's really great, good luck with that. And first I tried to bring it within Congress. I had this idea that if we had this place where all the bills were presented and all of the information from the organizations that staffers need to take into consideration when they're making a recommendation, if that was aggregated in one place and the constituent input was aggregated in one place, and anybody, you know, whether it's the media or the organizations or other members could find out what Congress was hearing, wouldn't that be great? And so I took it to places within Congress, and I found out that if you want to build a Democratic tool for House members, you could do that. Or if you wanted to build a Republican tool for senators, you could do that. But if you want to build something for Congress that makes Congress work better, good luck with that. There's really no office for that. We don't do that. And I found that with very few exceptions, the only office that is dedicated to making sure infrastructure in Congress works well for House, Senate, Democrat, and Republican is the architect of the Capitol. So they make sure the dome doesn't fall in and that the marble halls are polished, but other than that, other questions of infrastructure, it's very difficult to do something to benefit Congress as a whole. So I had the amazing luck of meeting Tim O'Reilly at the same time that I was kind of holding on to this list of things I thought someone should do to fix the way that Congress receives information and the way that people communicate with Congress. And he was on what I call these ambassadorial missions from the land of technology, coming to meet with staffers and talk about how entrepreneurs could help government work better and vice versa. And so I bent his ear one day and told him about my idea, and he said, you know, hey, if you decide to do this, give me a call. So I couldn't, it was one of those itches that you just have to scratch. You can't let it go. I became that person who just every conversation I steered it kind of towards, well, if we had this thing, you know, and I was so boring, my family was so sick of hearing about it. But I couldn't get it out of my head. And I found some wonderful co-founders to work with and decided to do it. And as I'm sure you know, there are ethical limitations on outside activities by congressional staffers. So I had to jump to do it and decided to come out here to breathe this wonderful, innovative Silicon Valley air and figure out how you start a startup. And it's been quite a ride ever since. What it has presented the wonderful opportunity for is having one foot in DC, one foot in Silicon Valley. And one foot in government, one foot in the innovative world of startups and the companies out here that drive the economy. And they're very different. I don't know if you've noticed. One of the analogies I like to give is how wonderfully generous people are in Silicon Valley with their connections, their time, and their advice. And it is so very different from the political world where your connections are your currency, your information is your currency, and they, you know, it you almost keep your cards like this, and you think, oh, you want to meet so-and-so? Let me see if I can, yeah, I might be able to make that happen for you. And Silicon Valley's like, oh, are you on LinkedIn? Oh, you know, let me connect you. And when I first came out here, experiencing the, oh, you should meet so-and-so, let's have coffee and I'll refer you around, just to see the serendipity that occurs in the Bay Area as those kinds of connections are formed. I think that there's a lot for DC to learn about that openness and this fail-fast mentality that allows things to be tried. It's much different in government. Our zero-sum political game makes that very difficult. But I also think there's a lot that Silicon Valley can learn about engaging with DC. And I think we'll talk a little bit about that, Roseanne, but I also think that people in this room have a lot more understanding about that. So I recently came across a book by a guy named Matt Grossman called The Not-So-Special Interests that really does a fantastic analysis of the groups and organizations in Washington that are effective. And he doesn't look into money, he doesn't look into kind of traditional views of effectiveness of an organization, size of organization, things like that. He looks to which organizations are actually effective. Are they called for hearings? You know, how are their policy positions advanced? Are they actually seeing policy impact from their activities? And some of the factors he finds that lend themselves to political effectiveness are so very interesting, and I think they actually circle back to the kinds of things that I saw working on the tornado in Jackson. And that what he identified was this certain element of civic confidence. So people who believe that they have the right and the ability to impact their government do. It's amazing. So what he saw was that it wasn't equated to necessarily all of the outside things that you would imagine indicate effectiveness. But voting, for example, was important, but it wasn't so much, I mean, yes, obviously voting's important to get the people that you or your organization agrees with in office, but it wasn't so much that element that was so effective. It was the actual act of organizing people to vote and interacting with people and feeling a part of this process. And the same was true of civic engagement at a local level, being involved with your local councils, your local chambers, being a part of your community. It made you feel like you deserve to be there and you were a part of this process and this is your government and you're gonna impact it, and your interaction with government at all levels becomes much more empowered. And so I love this idea of civic confidence and the idea that civic engagement at a local level actually plays into actual impact at the national level. So that's something that hopefully we can work on with PopVox. Broadening the feeling of access to government at all levels. One of the things that we said when we started to develop it was that we wanted it to be the opposite of big marble steps and columns that you look at and think, I'm not welcome there. So our idea is to lower the barriers to participation and to increase the transparency of interaction and help government make better decisions. So. Thank you so much for having me here, Roseanne.
Some of the things that Marci said, doesn't it touch a chord with all of us in the room here? I mean, can you relate to the access, to the ability to be able to get things done? I'm seeing the nodding of heads. What we're gonna do in our conversation today with Marci is we're gonna talk about how PopVox was born. Because Marci, PopVox was born at a dinner party back in 2009. And it was born between you and your co-founder, Rachna Chaudhry. And you came from very different perspectives, but yet sat next to each other at this dinner party. Can you share with the audience the perspectives and kind of who you both were and the space you were sitting in?
Sure. So I was coming at things as a staffer, and like I said, I'd been sitting with this list of all these things I thought someone should fix for a very long time. And Rachna was an advocate. She was a lobbyist for a nonprofit. And as we sat next to each other, she kind of gave me the, why do staffers always ask me questions about things that I don't even cover, and how come they never know that I sent them, you know, a list of letters 2 weeks ago from all of their constituents, and they don't even, I mean, it was a little bit of a, she wasn't very happy with staffers. And I said, well, do you have any idea how many letters are coming in and how many, you know, stacks of papers we get? And so we kind of had a mutual complaint fest for a little bit. And sat tensely at the dinner. And then I kind of was like, you know, I've got this idea.
And so for the for the rest of the dinner, we kind of talked about the list that I had, and she had her own list. She had for years been pulling together coalitions and trying to get, you know, or people who go in to have constituent meetings come and report back, and she had these, you know, intricate Google Docs that she'd organized so that people could share their information. And so she and I, and at the time we had a third technical co-founder, Josh Tauber, we all came together with a different understanding of our part of things. And the idea was to start to align the incentives of each. So the way things existed offline is that, you know, members of Congress didn't know if the information was coming from constituents, and there was a ton of it. It was hard to process. They were throwing up barriers on their website to submitting other letters. The organizations were trying to get through. It was hard to get through, so the answer was to yell louder. People didn't feel like their voices were being heard because they kind of weren't, and they were getting mad, so they'd send more stuff, and they were really angry, so they'd go to town hall meetings, yell. And it was just, there's this really ugly cacophony that was happening. And so our goal, and hey, we're still working on it, is to align the incentives so that members of Congress know they're hearing from constituents one time per issue. Verified. They know that the claims that the organizations are making are true, that they're backed up by constituents who are actually weighing in real people, and they're getting the information that they need to make decisions. So we're trying to bring a little harmony to a rough place.
And you know that the site was launched in November of 2010, and in the spring of 2011, you knew you were onto something big because there was a massive uptick and the site crashed. Tell the audience about that experience when the site actually crashed because of an issue that people were following.
Yeah, this was, now there have been so many potential government shutdowns, it's almost like you have to say which one. This was one of the earlier ones, and what was interesting about that was that the people who were weighing in were not just weighing in about the potential government shutdown. It was military families weighing in on a bill that had been introduced that would have guaranteed that military families would be paid in the event of a government shutdown. And what was so special about that input is that it wasn't just angry people railing against something they were upset about. There were very touching, real stories from people whose loved ones were serving overseas who were worried about how they were going to pay their rent. And those are it gives me chills still just thinking about it. Those are the kinds of stories that when I was a staffer, I would read and think, why isn't anyone talking about this? And so the ability to aggregate those stories, and you can still go find those stories on PopVox. I mean, what's so interesting is that it creates a record so that you can see what Congress was actually hearing during these times. Those personal stories really make an impact. And we actually just found out that the Library of Congress is going to start scraping PopVox to keep the input that's there as part of the historical record of the U.S.
Okay, so, that's fantastic. I mean, that's where you know that you've made a difference. And I think
I always say it's not the platform, it's not the tool. The voices make the difference. We're just a tool for getting the voices to the representatives.
And I think, Marci, we talk about the voices at this Progress Seminar. We talk about all the issues we discussed yesterday, and people ask us what happens afterwards. And it's the voices of all the people in the room today that make a difference on the different issues. It's what you take back from this and the connections that you make. So there is that leverage. And that's why when Amy and I sat down with you and we were talking about PopVox, we said, oh my gosh, this audience that comes to the Progress Seminar, there is such synergy between the people in this room and what your platform is doing. Now, what is very fascinating, and if any of you have done any research on Marci and Roshna about their backgrounds, one has a law degree and a master's and in public policy. Neither of them have tech backgrounds. So how do you launch something that is very technical with the two co-founders not having a technical background? So will you talk about, you mentioned a third person, mm-hmm. and so to build the platform.
Sure, so like you said, we had a tech co-founder initially, and also you know, and constantly are working with a fabulous team. We actually have the majority of our coders are female, which is a wonderful milestone. But I think a really important thing to keep in mind is that there was a time when starting a company or a tech company required that you really understood how all the gears worked and the programming and the algorithms and how it all fit together. And you know, still, if you're going to invent some new technology, that's the case. But for applying existing technology to a problem, that's something that we now all can imagine. So you don't need to wait until the kid sitting in the dorm room at Harvard figures out your problem and goes to work on it. Now, you know, you've all got high-speed computers in your pocket, and you can imagine how technology can be applied to your very specific industry or problem. And so I think we're in this really interesting time now where the earlier time was the reason we got so many dating, photo sharing, shopping apps. You know, those were the problems of the people who were doing the coding. But now, how many dating apps are there? But now, whether it's your specific, I've had so many wonderful conversations and I'm so fascinated by the innovation that's currently happening in legal tech. That is an industry that is slow to innovate. But, you know, it is also one of the most information-intense industries out there. And now so many people are looking at the processes that take place in law firms and federal courts and other places and saying, you know, if I could just see a list here or we could visualize this, that would be great. That doesn't mean they're programming it. They can go find wonderful people to work with to program it, but they can imagine how the technology can solve their problem.
Well, and that kind of leads to the next question, which is, how does PopVox work? So congress.gov posts a bill, and then you have proprietary software. So kind of tell us what happens when the bill gets posted, and then you want the information on PopVox. How does this all work? Because how can people here, our constituents, follow it?
Sure. So so previously thomas.gov and they're transitioning at the Library of Congress to congress.gov. Post the bills as they make their way through the process from being introduced to the clerk to the government printing office over to the Library of Congress. It is a very convoluted, not necessarily so smooth process. But we scrape the bills as they're introduced. And the reason that that's important is because we're not editorializing. So the bill information, the sponsors, the co-sponsors, the summary from the nonpartisan Congressional Research Service, the status of the bill, et cetera, all goes into PopVox, and so each bill automatically gets its own page created. And then organizations, companies, we call them stakeholders, so companies, organizations, civic groups, and sometimes a loose, group of citizens who've gotten together because they care about an issue, come create a profile and choose to endorse or oppose the bill and post their statement. This is important because it is solving my problem as a staffer. Which is that when I was there, again, huge stack of one-pagers, it was always so hard to go answer the question, who's on this bill? Who supports it? Who's against it? There's a list at the speaker's office. There's a list at the sponsor's office. There's a list in the committee office. You know, somebody just sent their endorsement letter to the newspaper. What does it mean to endorse a bill? So our goal was to create a place where all of that would be aggregated in one place. And so now, the House Democrats, their internal intranet picks up the information about those endorsement letters from PopVox via API. So if somebody registers their support statement on PopVox, it automatically shows up on DemCom within the House Democrats staffers' internal intranet. We're hoping to get that adopted by all. But then also individuals can come to PopVox and post their statement supporting or opposing a bill, which is then we verify that they're a real constituent, we deliver their message to Congress, the individual kind of maintains their history of what they've written to Congress throughout the years. You can see the history of when it gets delivered, and then also get updates on related bills and things like that. So for example, I just saw an update went out for people who'd weighed in on the Data Transparency Act, which just passed the Senate, is going back to the House. those people probably would have gotten a reminder that, or an alert that the Public Online Information Act was just introduced. So they might be interested in going to express their opinion on that.
Well, that brings us, because you touched on it, you said, okay, so the Democrats pull information from PopVox. And one of the things, I think this audience is very, very in tune to the fact that people want to have a voice. But some people want to have a voice depending on their particular bend in any type of information, whether you're a Democrat, Republican, nonpartisan, whether you're this special interest or that. So how has the reception been in Congress towards PopVox? I mean, I'm sure that there were some voices that were like, do we really want this type of tool? Because of the fact that you had approached it for several years as a staffer saying, how can we fix that? We're not Democrats, we're not Republicans, we want to fix our voice with Congress. So what has the reception been? Not asking you to name names or anything, but can you tell us stories about what people have said?
Sure. So I think the most important point is to emphasize that information that goes to Congress through PopVox is not information from PopVox. It's information from the constituent to the member of Congress through their electronic web forms. It's basically just a delivery system. So in that sense, members are happy to hear from their constituents, and staffers are very happy to get that information in a way that is formatted to their systems. So even though we make it easier for people to weigh in and potentially increase the amount of incoming information, it's just inevitable because we've made it easier, we also take extreme efforts to format the incoming in a way that, to the greatest extent possible, self-sorts itself within the office so that they can quickly see what they're receiving and kick out a response and kind of begin to bring some relief to the Lucy and Ethel in the Chocolate Factory process of getting through constituent mail. So the response within Congress has been fantastic. What's been interesting has been a bit on the outside to see the reticence of some groups that are used to keeping their lists and their advocacy information very closely held. In the past, without a leaderboard or a transparent count of what people are saying, it's very easy to put out a press release, a million people support this, a million people oppose that. We just delivered a petition with 10 million names. Those kinds of claims, which when you're on the receiving end, you kind of think, is this, well, I don't know if this is true. PopVox eliminates the ability to do that. So it's been interesting to see some reticence on the part of organizations that are a little bit nervous about the transparency that we provide.
And the actual numbers
that
are out there that can show what's happening. Yeah. Well, there was an article in Forbes magazine in early February, and it outlined who your current users are. Can you tell us more about them? I mean, I'm sure everyone is curious, who's using PopVox? How is it being used out there?
I think that what we have is kind of a 1.0 version. We've brought what existed offline online. So from everything that we can tell, the people who are currently using PopVox to contact Congress, are about two-thirds of them were already contacting Congress. And about a third of them are new to contacting Congress. So we have about 350,000 registered users who have signed in, created an account, written to Congress, and come back regularly to weigh in. But one of the questions we often get is, oh, are these the kids? Are these the millennials weighing in? And it's not yet. The kids, the millennials, they're tweeting and And so part of our challenge is to educate them about the fact that tweeting to the air is not effective advocacy. You still have a responsibility to contact your member and share a personal story. It takes, one of the stories that we hear frequently from staffers is they assign level of intention and importance to the message they receive kind of in direct proportion to the effort it appears it took to send that message in. And so while we're trying to make it easier for people to express their opinion, we also want to make it very clear that engaging and sharing a personal story and knowing something about the bill you're weighing in on and being informed is still, you know, back to the point of civic confidence, being an actual responsive, active participant, not this is not clicktivism. So we constantly are working on helping people become more educated about the process. But our users are in every congressional district. That happened very soon. We were so proud. We have no idea how it happened, except that it appears that people shared via Facebook, Twitter, and things like that, and just moved their own networks. So it was very organic. So the organizations that have been on the site and kind of conducting campaigns, which is, I know one of your questions is, how do we monetize? Organizations can create a pro campaign and use a widget, put it on their site to help people weigh in. So one of our interesting groups is Penny for NASA. So people asking for more funding for NASA. So we have, you know, people interested in space and others. Also the Airline Pilots Association, a lot of aeronautical people using PopVox for some reason, quite a few health groups and public knowledge. Some of the, obviously SOPA was a really big issue on PopVox back in 2012. So, you know, in a lot of ways, the ticks on the site follow what people are advocating about. That's interesting, and I like watching it. I think it's fascinating to see a record of what's getting people really fired up. But I also really love watching the bills that will never be in the headlines. You know, whether nurse practitioners are compensated under Medicare, or whether, you know, this particular regulation to change the tax code for nonprofits. That was in the headline. But the smaller bills that have smaller organizations and constituents that really care about the issues, that's where I think the transparency is fascinating, because those are the issues that you would never hear about otherwise.
And we have two more questions, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. So you touched on the monetization part of it, and I think people are wondering, how does PopVox, first of all, you mentioned Tim O'Reilly, mm-hmm. So O'Reilly Media, and I know that he was an early investor, and then kind of how does the rest of the financial piece work?
Yeah, so we're a civic startup, and we're not the only one. We didn't make up that term, but it's still an evolving term. So we kind of describe ourselves as existing in the middle of the Venn diagram between a nonprofit and a for-profit. We are a mission-driven for-profit company. And that means that a lot of the decisions that we make are not made in the way a traditional startup would make them. So we don't sell user data. We decided not to take advertising. It was something that we thought we were going to do initially, and found out for two reasons. One, the Senate wouldn't link to us if we had ads on the page, and we decided it was better to have them link to us. And two, we also don't want to create opportunities for people to be tracked in ways that they don't want to be within their political lives. So we make decisions constantly that focus on our civic mission. But as far as the company, we're set up as a for-profit. We've had primarily angel investment, and Tim O'Reilly was our first angel. We've also tapped our families in every way possible. Thanks, guys. And then our monetization is that organizations can run pro campaigns using our widgets. It's free for any organization to pick up a widget, put it on their website, but if an organization wants analytics on how many people are taking action, that's a pro product.
Well then, to this group is, as you mentioned, when you talked about mayors, if mayors could run everything. Well, city council, I think it all factors in. So the big question, and Amy and I had this when we sat down with you, is when do we get a local version of PopVox? When do we get something that each of our communities could use to work with our residents? Is that something we're thinking about?
We get the question all the time, and we definitely are kind of in the early stages of working on a California version, which would be our first state version. I mentioned we're not the only civic startup. There are lots of companies that and organizations, they all fall in different places in that Venn diagram, that are working on local engagement tools. And so far, our strategy has been to work with them in partnership. In the startup world, there's this term about companies that try to boil the ocean. And we're trying very hard not to do that. So we want to focus, you know, very strongly on what we do better than anyone else, and then work with others who are kind of covering the other pieces. But that said, there's a lot of economies of scale of applying, you know, legislative tools at the national level to the state level and potentially at the local level. And then also, you know, cracking the holy grail of helping people be involved and informed in a way that doesn't require them to spend all day doing it, is really the civic engagement challenge of our time now, because people can be involved more than ever before. They are, and they will be in the future. But the question is how, and this I think is a kind of shift that's coming from activism top down, have to be really fired up, angry, or scared to go take action, to more of a sustained participation that is informed and engaged and concerned, but is not always, you know, hair on fire activism. And I think that's where there's so much to be learned from civic engagement at the local level, where people are engaged and informed, and back to the point, much more practical and bipartisan, cooperative, because you have to be at the local level.
How many folks in the room would want to be a part of an incubator project with Marci on developing this locally? I'm going to see a lot of hands. I mean, we have kind of a ready, willing audience, but let's open it up. This is not a shy crowd. It's never been shy.
I've heard.
So, Paul?
Marci, great presentation and a very interesting and close to my heart topic of just
Thank
getting
you.
To Congress and talking about it. How do you compare with congress.org bill check?
So we don't, we do provide, the question just to repeat for anybody was, how do we compare with congress.org build track, which I'm not sure if they're still doing. That was a CQ project. No worries. This is kind of to the point of us trying to work with organizations that are doing other things really well. So our key piece is delivering the messages to Congress. We actually see a lot of traffic and kind of cross-pollinization from places where people go to learn about issues in other places. So I'm not quite sure if the congress.org piece is still going, but certainly congress.gov is a place where people go to, and it's a phenomenal new site from the Library of Congress that allows you to get a lot of information about the bills. And whether you're there learning about it, or you read about it in the newspaper, or somebody tells you about a bill on Facebook, our goal at PopVox is to be that next, okay, so now what do I do about it? So we think that we're kind of that next piece to activate people once you've figured out what you think about. Exactly.
So Paul just said the organizational funnel. I mean, that's kind of where PopVox's space is. Alan, and then Sherry has a question. So,
I'm interested in what kind of media response have you gathered? Are there big media outlets out there that are saying, here are the hot topics that are trending on PopVox now, and this is what the public is trying to interact with Congress about?
Yeah, so we've had obviously some pickup in some media outlets. Huffington Post for a while was they put a widget if they talk about a bill on the site. Topics Politics, which is out here in the Bay Area, they do a link to PopVox when they talk about certain bills. Several media outlets subscribe to our top 20, which comes out every week and kind of shows you which bills are trending. The important thing that we always emphasize is that PopVox is not a poll, so we never want to say these are, you know, the things that people in the United States care about. We always really couch it with, this is what people are saying on PopVox, because the people who have self-selected and activated around an issue are so different from the ones that are, you know, from the opinions that would be there if you polled 1,000 neutral people. So we're so cautious about pushing the message out, and we're trying to figure out how to do it in a way that doesn't try to fuel a story. So it's We've kind of, I think I told you this, we've erred on the side of being boring on purpose because we're so sensitive to trying to jazz people up about something. And so how we handle that with the media has so far been to tippy toe. But I do think that there are, there's information about the issues that start to bubble up that is an invaluable resource that you will start to see more of.
And I would encourage, I'm going to go to Sherry, I would encourage you all to pull the article off of Forbes. And it is the February 1st edition of Forbes. And it's called The Future of Political Engagement is Here. And it's called PopVox. This is a great kind of summary of some of our discussion points this morning. And it's really helpful because when you go on the PopVox website and you start looking at it and you register as a user, it is so fascinating. You could spend, because, okay, by and large, the audience that we have here, you're all very committed, caring, politically involved people. And so when you get into a website like this, and you can see I'm getting very excited about it, it is absolutely...
Our media strategy.
It is absolutely fascinating because Marci said it's about educating and engaging and informing. And how many of us want our constituents and our stakeholders, whether we're in the healthcare space, whether we're in the education space, whether we're in the NGO of any type space, whether we're local government officials, how many of us want, we talked about it yesterday with Mary Huss, how many of us want our folks informed and engaged and educated? I'd say, can everybody raise their hand on this one? Because otherwise you're asleep. Because we, and I can understand that too, but it is just the way Sunday morning works. But we want the people that we work with to have a basis and an understanding. Go on PopVox, register as a user. There is such a wealth of information, and it really helps a local official sort of understand what could be coming down the pike. So it is, I mean, it's incredibly exciting, and it's very exciting as to where it's going to go from here. But Sherry, I know you're Sherry Sager, who is head of government affairs at Lucile Packard Children's Hospital. Sherry, you are one of the most politically engaged and knowledgeable individuals in this room. So I hope it's a good question, Sherry. No pressure.
Especially, I would argue, on the state level, where there seems to be a real nothing. A lot of us have used programs and services like CapWiz for years, which seems to do part of what you're saying. So talk a little bit how, because, for example, we're a children's hospital, we're a regional entity. So yes, we have a member of Congress who actually represents the physical being of the hospital, but I consider, frankly, everybody in the Bay Area be our members, and those are who I meet with, who I talk to, and when we do letter writing campaigns and have our employees, our patients, our constituents write, they write to their own member. How do you help us, CapWiz helps us organize that, how can you help us organize that, and what additional services would you be able to provide for us?
It's a great question. So it was a good one.
Did everyone hear the question?
I can repeat a bit. So the question was how PopVox relates to services like CapWiz, which have been around for a very long time. It started as a directory that helped you find the phone number to call Congress back when the original founder started it. We had a long chat a few years ago. So that's kind of a software as a service tool for organizations to organize their list, and you know they provide a way for you to write to Congress and they deliver the message. That's almost kind of how the back end of PopVox works. But what the add-on piece that we have is the public facing side. So especially actually the children's hospital example is one of those that I would almost use as the perfect example for why this is important. Because when you have a bill that comes out, you know, or appropriations, whatever it happens to be, that comes out that your people are advocating around, your patients, your families, your doctors, et cetera, and they're writing their message to Congress explaining how that bill affects children in your district. Those are the kinds of letters I would have received as a staffer saying, I shouldn't be the only one hearing this. And so while, you know, another service might deliver the message, with PopVox, the message is delivered, but it also shows up on a map that says, here are all the messages that are coming in from around the country. And you can, I mean, it's anonymous in that you have a screen name and it shows you the district it's from, but you can see the message and you can share it on Facebook. You can, you know, share it on Twitter, and then anybody who clicks it gets directed back to the page that says, if you agree with this person, you know, click here to write your own story or vote yes. So it provides the opportunity for those very important stories to kind of become part of the debate. And even if you wanted to, you know, write a letter to the editor and link back and say, this is what people are saying in the district. Or if you have people in your network, hospitals in your network in other parts of the country where they're writing to this or that member on a significant committee, as you go in to have your lobby meetings, to be able to pull up that map, and even the members that you're meeting with who are outside your district, you know what their constituents are telling them. That becomes a very powerful tool.
Other? Jim, and then Keith.
I think you said that as part of your service, you verify that someone's real or a constituent. How do you do that?
Yeah. Well, it's not Fort Knox. I mean, it's not 100%. We bounce their address against three different databases to make sure it's a real address within the district. They have to verify their email address, so there's a physical human step to doing it. We watch IP addresses and things like that to make sure we're not being gamed. So I would say it's 99% verified. We don't take, you know, fingerprints or driver's license or vote. And we also don't take voter registration. This is an important distinction between some of the other advocacy services that came out a few years ago. There was a focus on registered voters. This is from my experience as a staffer. You don't have to be a voter to be a constituent. You don't have, you know, you, there are plenty of people who are not citizens who pay taxes. There are plenty of people who you know, are not 18 and they have something they'd like to write to Congress. So we don't verify based on voter registration. We verify based on the physical address. And one of the largest challenges is dealing with Americans abroad who are trying to figure out whose district they're in. But it's so important for them to understand that they can't just write to the wind and ask for representation. I mean, their association with a congressional district is still a very powerful tool for them in advocacy.
Keith?
Yes, a lot of people in this room know that I'm alumni of the United States Marine Corps. And as such,
thank you for your support.
Characteristic. But I've seen a lot of stuff that's been happening in our government, and I've unfortunately become reluctant and fearful to register with your kind of organization, because maybe when that happens, I'll have agents from the IRS or the NSA come visiting. How do you address that kind of?
You know, it's not an uncommon concern that we hear from users about the way that data is handled, and we are obsessive about privacy. The other concern that we get is that members of Congress will receive someone's name, address, or phone number and start calling them for campaign issues. And what we always have to explain is that, you know, members of Congress in their official office are extremely limited in how the data is handled. So in the legislative branch, there is no share between the legislative branch and the executive branch. I mean, NSA notwithstanding, I don't know how that works, but members of Congress are not allowed to share the input that comes in from constituents with their campaign. They don't share it with the administration. I mean, The way that data is handled within the congressional office is a very kind of lockbox type system. For PopVox, the way that we handle it is that an individual who creates an account and writes a message owns their data. We deliver it to Congress. So, you know, once it's in the congressional office, Congress does what it does with it. But if the individual, even if they've come through an organization or whatever, if the individual wants to delete their message, delete their account, you know, they remain in control. They own that data. And that's the way we handle that. I see from your face, I don't think that answered your concern about the larger kind of PRISM NSA question. I would say that PopVox is about advocacy in public. We have this tradition in the United States, the secret ballot versus the public square. PopVox is the online public square. So there is, you have the ability to have a screen name and display publicly your congressional district so that, you know, if you have an unpopular opinion in a small town, you're not identified as the person with that opinion. But it's not the place for advocacy if you have something that you'd like to share with a member that you don't want other people to know. The power of PopVox is in publicly aggregating voices around an issue.
Thank you, Marci. People realize in the audience, though, Keith, and I'm going to tease you now because we've known each other a long time. We've been tracking you for years, okay?
Yeah.
So, and frankly, you're still getting into this venue, so we're good. We're okay. Anybody that has experienced Keith's questions before, we're all getting this. So, and we, you know how much respect I have for you, so I can make that joke.
But it's a very common concern, too. We hear it a lot.
Absolutely. We have, let's see, Paul Shepard, but there was a gentleman, I think it's...
Joko. How do you measure outcomes? Do you measure outcomes? Are you able to see how your traffic moves the needle on a particular vote?
Joe is a brand new city council member in San Mateo.
Congratulations. Joe. So were you in this thing off last night? No.
No, he didn't wear the coconut, okay. I don't think.
So the question of what produces outcomes is one that I'm super interested in, but no, we don't track. I mean, we are starting some initial analysis of what is a successful constituent message, what do staffers say moves the needle most. We work a lot with the research from the Congressional Management Foundation, which is, in my opinion, the expert on how congressional offices work and what is the most effective advocacy. That is actually where we pull the statistics when it's time to explain that personal stories make a difference, that you should never fax something to a congressional office, you know, things like that. But actually, right now we're working through a grant from Google to kind of look in and measure the kinds of input that people are leaving and how we might be able to help people write better, tell better stories. For example, we just recently changed the default on PopVox from no, I don't have anything to add to yes, I have a personal story. That seems like such a basic thing, but what we realized is we know that personal stories work. We know that personal stories are much more effective. Our default on the site should be to the thing that we know is most effective. So. It's not so much quantitative, but we are taking steps on the qualitative side.
Thank you, Joe. Paul Shepard?
I appreciate your description that you are a profit-oriented business. I'm working for one and hopes to be one.
Well, I would put us in that category, too.
That brings up the question, well, how do you get paid and who pays you?
Mm-hmm. So as I was mentioning, the pro advocacy tools that we make, so it's free for individuals to use PopVox. It's free for Congress to use PopVox. For advocacy organizations, groups, anybody who has got a legislative agenda, they can use it for free too. They create a profile, they say, I endorse or oppose this bill, here's my statement. I want to pick up a widget and put it on my website so all my people can go and weigh in there. If, however, they want to see our fancy dashboard with the map and the funnel of X people hit your page and X people left their address and X people wrote a message, and if they want to get this dashboard so that they can manage their campaign, that is a pro service. And so then the organizations that pay for that are kind of the ones that I was mentioning that span from Space Advocates, which is working on the NASA issue, to Public Knowledge, which is working on the free internet issue, to health groups that are working on their particular kind of funding issue within appropriations bills, et cetera.
Thank you, Paul. Paul Shepard, Cargill, so one of the largest private companies in the world. Anyone else? Do you have any? Danny?
Do you do anything with constituency groups where they have an idea that they'd like to present to Congress or their congressperson, or is it only reactive to whatever bill is being posted?
That's a great question, and it's actually something that came up like right out of the gate. And at first I resisted so much because as a former staffer, I was like, yeah, it has to be tied to bills, and we're working on bills. But there are so many things that are not yet bills. And so we introduced something called a sponsored action. So actually this kind of works with the pro product, but an organization could sponsor an action that goes up on PopVox as a bill, I mean, in the same format as a bill, so people can still support or oppose it. You don't get to sponsor an action that people can only support. Organizations can come in and support or oppose it. But it just says, it says very clearly this is a sponsored action by X organization.
Thank you. Danny is with the Lung Cancer Foundation, the Bonnie Deodario.
So. And apparently started coming to these things when she was like 12. Yeah. I saw you raise your hand.
I want to say, when Marci saw the number of people that have been coming here 20 years or more, she looked out, she goes, they must have been coming when they were really, really young. So, okay, I think she deserves a huge shout out.
You're a good-looking group.
How about one final question? Deb, one final question? Paul, it's yours.
Thank you. Let's say I have an interest in a topic that some people might be interested in, like campaign finance. And I'm interested in making sure my legislators know about that, mm-hmm. about my opinions on this and that. How does PopVox help me get that information to mm-hmm. my legislators and then others get involved with it?
Yeah, that's a great example. So the question was about, you know, if I care about campaign finance, how does PopVox help me? So it's a great example, especially given the recent Supreme Court decision. One of the things that we do, we don't editorialize issues or topics of issues or whatever, but we frequently do what we call issue spotlights, which is basically just picking an issue, pulling together all the bills that relate to it, giving, you know, a few lines of the history or where these bills happen to sit in Congress, and giving you a list of the bills. Sometimes they get crazy. I mean, we started that last year with gun control, and now the list of bills that relate to gun control is over 100. But you can go find that issue spotlight. But for McCutcheon, we pulled together an updated issue spotlight. So on the PopVox blog, you can find all of the bills that have been introduced related to campaign finance with a little blurb about the Supreme Court decision. And then for you, what you would do is go through and you know, read the information about the bills. If you're really into it, you could read the bill text. You can see what organizations have posted a statement on either supporting or opposing the various bills that have been introduced. And just as an FYI, the organizations upload those positions themselves, or the congressional staffers send them to us as they get those letters in. And then you would choose to support or oppose the bill, write your message to Congress, send it. And then I think probably the most effective thing to do would be then to share your letter, which, you know, will have its own page on PopVox, via Facebook, via Twitter, to your email list, and say, this is what I wrote to Congress about this bill. I invite you to do the same. And, you know, that, even with that, you're not a well-financed organization, but you probably have an email list of 50 or 60 or so people that you could share that with, and it's you know, a no-cost way to actually create the kinds of advocacy tactics and tools or procedures that we know work.
So it helps me form my story, too.
Helps you form your story, yeah. And you can also go in and see what others have written, which is what we really want to encourage and what we hear a lot of people actually find most helpful in PopVox is seeing what others had to say. Thank you.
Paul brought up campaign finance, but he is a transportation guru trying to fix the 101-84 interchange.
Bless your heart.
So, look out for future PopVox information on the 101-84 interchange.
But that bill's coming back. Transportation bill's coming back up.
Or we have our fingers crossed, everyone in this room. I'm going to ask our chair of the board, Gino Gasparini, to come up. But as Gino is coming up, let's thank Marci Harris.
Thank you for having us.
For more videos from the Progress Seminar, go to www.pentv.tv/videos/specials/progressseminar.